Well, we've got with us, I believe, Scott Peyton, who is the Mississippi Director of Right on Crime. Scott, how are you doing?
I am doing great this morning.
Scott, now you're in the Delta today, is that right?
I am in Greenwood at the Elks Lodge in downtown Greenwood.
That's great. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what y'all have got going on there today?
Well, today we have an employer engagement forum. And what this is we're taking the local experts here in the Delta region and in Greenwood, gathering them all under one roof, and we're going to talk to employers and the community about second chance hiring. You know, as a conservative organization, we want to make sure that the criminal justice system is being evaluated on whether it produces the best possible result at the lowest possible cost. With that best possible result would be public safety. And one of the major predictors of recidivism, which is a return to prison, is unemployment. And, you know, community supervision, which is probation and parole, began back in the 1800s with John Augustus, who was a shoemaker. He takes in an individual that's at court that had an alcohol problem. He promises the court that he will help this individual, put him to work, and get things going. And that's how the probation and parole system began. Now, with big government, it has grown to this humongous system, and I think it's lost the focus of one, protecting the public, and two, helping the individual reintegrate back into society, as opposed to having them in prison or having them go directly to jail. So today, our business community with the labor shortage is missing out on a really good opportunity for individuals that have done the time. Have paid the price for and the consequence for what they've done, and now they're looking for that opportunity to get back in the workforce, to, you know, support their family, to become, you know, taxpayers instead of tax burdens.
So today, the focus today is really you all talking to the business community, potential employers, to try to help them understand this opportunity that may be there to find good workers who are trying to reintegrate into society.
Absolutely. What we're going to do is we're going to have representatives from MDOC to let employers know about the programming that happens inside the prisons, the technical training, the soft skills, basically the things that are being done to make sure that when an individual comes out of prison, they leave it better than when they came in. In addition to that, we want to highlight the programs that are already in place, like the MDES, Mississippi Department of Employment Securities, will be here. They will be talking to employers about the Work Opportunity Tax Credit, the Federal Bonding Program, which are all programs that are available to Mississippi employers at the moment. But there are special tax incentives for employers that hire individuals that have criminal backgrounds.
So explain that to us a little bit. How do those programs work if you're an employer thinking about hiring somebody?
It is a federal program, but it's administered through the Mississippi Department of Employment Securities. There's a $2,400 tax credit for employers that hire individuals that have a criminal background. What you would need to do is get in touch with MDES, and that's why we're going to have the local rep for the Delta region here today. And they will sign up employers and will walk them through the process, because that program also allows tax credits for individuals that are receiving government assistance like FITAP. There's a $6,000 tax credit for veterans. So there's a lot of other opportunities there that employers may be missing out as well to save money on their federal taxes. And then the federal bonding program is a free kind of like a liability insurance for employers that they can have for 6 months. And then after that 6 month time is up, they have the option to purchase coverage at a really reduced rate through MDES.
I assume, maybe you can talk a little bit about this, Scott, I assume it's difficult for some people who are coming out of prison to find work even when they're looking for it.
Absolutely, Lucien. I was a probation and parole officer for 10 years. And the main question or the main issue that any individual had on probation or parole was they needed a job. The problem lies in that there's such a stigma with individuals that have been to prison and the stigma that's associated with having a criminal background, and that many employers, when they see the felony or hear about the felony in the interview, they tune everything else out. What we're asking and what we've been working with employers on is to first see if that individual is a good fit for your organization. I mean, not everyone that has a criminal record is going to be a great employee. Not everyone that has a criminal record is going to be a bad employee, but I think you can say the same for individuals that have a clean record as well.
Right.
But we want employers to get to know the individual, see if they're a fit for your organization. If they are, then look at that criminal offense. How long ago was it? If it's something, 6 to 10 years ago, chances are, and that individual hasn't committed another crime, research evidence shows that individual's more than likely has the same chance of getting in trouble as any one of us do. Then see if the offense relates to the position that they're applying for. If it's a customer service position and this individual has a lot of, a criminal history that indicates maybe they have a short temper, deal well with the public, then that's somebody you wouldn't want to consider. But it needs to be an individual basis. Unfortunately, a lot of times in the criminal justice system, we want this one size fits all. And that's why we have so many different players with a lot of discretion in the criminal justice system. The district attorney, the judges, sentencing has different variables. So it is an individualized system, and employers with the labor shortage, with unemployment, especially here in the Delta region, I understand the unemployment here is probably 1.5, maybe 2 points higher in the Delta region than it is across the state. It's important to combat this cycle of recidivism, to prevent these individuals from going back to prison, to keep families together, and to grow the economy. And what happens in these small towns and small areas is when crime rates increase, these businesses move out. When they move out, these individuals that are already having a hard time getting a job, they are already faced with housing and transportation. They can't drive to Jackson. They can't drive an hour and a half out to get employment. So the process gets larger and larger, and we end up having people go back to prison that really don't need to go back to prison.
And I would assume, and you touched on this a little bit earlier with recidivism, which as you know, and as I imagine most of our listeners know, is people who reoffend and end up going back to prison after getting out. I would assume that somebody who gets out, wants to get a job, can't find a job, at some point might end up going back to criminal activity because they have to provide for themselves, provide for their family, and if they can't get a job that sustains them, that there's a temptation to go down that criminal path to try to meet those economic needs.
Exactly. And it's also a frustration factor. You can imagine someone that had served 3 or 4 years in prison, gets this technical training, is told the whole time that, do these things, better yourself. When you come out, you have all the tools you need. And a lot of times they do come out with the majority of the tools that they need. But like you said, they meet these roadblocks, the discouragement of not being able to find a job, and simply because of just a blanket exclusion that jobs are excluding people with felonies. And we're also talking about employment that's going to pay someone a livable wage, a job that they can have for an extended period of time, that's a career that they can grow with. And that's what we want to show employers is that. Studies show that individuals that have been given a second chance are more loyal, they're more dedicated, because they know that, one, their freedom rides on this, more than likely, and they also realize that they may not get a third chance at getting a good job and being productive citizens.
Well, Scott, we're coming up on a break. Can you stick with us for another segment?
Yes, sir, I sure can.
That sounds great. This is Lucien Smith in for Paul Gallo here on the Gallo Radio Show on Super Talk Mississippi. See, well, we were talking before the break and still have with us Scott Peyton. Scott is the Mississippi director of the Right on Crime organization, who is in Greenwood today for a forum for employers. Scott, one thing we were talking about beforehand was some of the training that people who are incarcerated receive. I mean, can you? I know you'll have an MDOC rep there today, but can you talk a little bit more about what people are getting to prepare them to reenter society to hopefully enter the workforce?
Sure, Lucien. And this is one area that we need to continue here in Mississippi working on towards is instilling and creating a robust programming inside of the Mississippi prisons. Today we're going to have an individual at the Mississippi Delta Community College. They are working with MDOC up in the Delta region to provide basically the same type of college courses on a limited scale for individuals that are incarcerated. We're also working with the Mississippi Community College Board. They work directly with MDOC in developing a curriculum for training. One of the initial, I guess, immediate issues when someone goes into prison is education. So the HISET, which used to be GED, those type of programs are important, and they're kind of the base to start from. After that, there's different technical programs. You may have seen on the news the welding program, the mobile welding program that was moving around. Other technical skills that are matched with what industry needs here in Mississippi, whether it's welding, HVAC, those type of programming. The important part is MDOC has to work closely to make sure that they don't offer programs inside the prison that someone coming out can't do. For example, in California and some of the other states, they have inmates that work putting out fires. But when they get out of prison, they're unable to do that type of work because of the restrictions against felony convictions. And we've seen that in many other states too, where they've worked with certain types of vocations inside the prison, then an individual gets out and is prohibited from doing that type of work. But the basics are trying to get the HISET, and then also addressing there's programs that are evidence-based, like Thinking for a Change, that helps individuals work through anger management and other issues that may have got them in trouble in the first place. And then obviously addressing substance abuse and hopefully picking up or identifying any mental health needs that individual has. The important part comes, and that's what's really important with the passage of SB 2795, the Earned Parole Act, two sessions ago, is that everything that happens inside MDOC, that needs to transition to the parole officer. And they need to be able to understand what has happened the last few years that person's been in prison, and then help work through this plan to successfully move them forward. Because whatever they did inside a prison, it's a whole different ball game when you're out. There's many other factors coming. So that's why it's so important to continue that supervision through parole, where the parole officer can guide and direct that person. And kind of what we're trying to do today is take some of that burden off the employer, off the probation officers. When I was a probation and parole officer, I had to be an expert in everything, whether it was substance abuse, mental health. I had to be able to identify it, refer it, help someone get a job. So it's great to see partnerships with other state agencies, with other nonprofits that are out doing this kind of work. For example, Goodwill. Goodwill, since the 1800s, has been helping individuals become job ready, to remove people from poverty, put them back into the workforce. And in Jackson, they're doing a great job of working with Rankin County Sheriff's Department, with MDOC, with a lot of other resources to help bring people back into the community and help them with the soft skills and the training that they need as well. We see employers in general talk about the workforce not being trained, not having the soft skills, not knowing how to dress, not knowing how to interact with the employer. And those are kind of things that are being taught to the individuals that are inside the prison walls as well.
Well, that's great. I mean, because, and again, we've got Scott Peyton, who's the state director of Right on Crime. And if you want to be part of the conversation, contact us on the C Spire text line at 601-879-4395. But I think it's great that we're doing this sort of thing, because at the end of the day, that's the goal. Obviously, you want to remove people from society who are dangerous, if they're going to remain dangerous. You want to deter future crime. But if somebody goes to prison, I mean, the goal is they come out and become a productive member of society, work a job that's legitimate and legal, and are a producer for society rather than a drain on it. If people are interested, I mean, is this, if people are in the Delta or otherwise and feel like driving to the conference today, can anybody show up and attend today, Scott?
Absolutely, Lucien. We're going to be opening the doors here at 8 a.m. They're welcome to come in at any point between 8 and 12. We're serving lunch at the end with from Bread and Butter, which is a local Greenwood eatery. So, and actually, there'll be a lot of networking during lunch where the different service providers, the on-the-ground people that are doing the day-to-day work, and that's kind of another focus of our forum. We want to highlight the people, the organizations, the faith groups that are out here that have been doing this work for years. Some like to say they were doing the work before reentry was cool. And, you know, that's a big focus. And you hit the high points with these are people that have already been sentenced. They've completed their sentence or they're completing their sentence through probation and parole. And they've paid the price and they've suffered the consequence of their illegal act. And as a conservative, and I think just as someone interested in public safety, there are consequences for criminal acts, and that we don't deny, and we support that. But it must be proportional to the crime. And at some point, the stigma or the price that they pay has to stop if they've done what they need to do, and they show a willingness to want to move forward. And, you know, that provides hope. Hope leads to redemption, and hope and redemption are a good mix to have a safer Mississippi, where we can raise a family, where we can attract great minds to our state to work and be, you know, be the best version of Mississippi that we can be. I mean, we see it happen when storms happen, when natural disasters happen. The good people in Mississippi come together to help one another. And I think employers, the community can come together and help individuals that want that second chance, that are looking for a better path, a different path.
Scott, tell us a little bit about the Right on Crime organization. I think a lot of people, when they hear, and I've worked with Right on Crime when I was in Governor Bryant's office and we did some criminal justice reform, but I think people hear right-sizing sentences and that sort of thing, and they immediately assume, well, this must be some sort of left-wing organization who wants to let all the bad guys out of jail, quit prosecuting folks. I know that's not the case, but why don't you tell us a little more about Right on Crime and what all y'all do?
Sure, I appreciate that. Yes, it's a tough time for criminal justice policy reform because it's been getting such a horrendous bad name, and rightfully so in many cases. But Right on Crime is a national initiative of the Texas Public Policy Foundation. It was founded in the early 2000s when Texas was going through the Justice Reinvestment Initiative. Brooke Rollins, who worked in the Trump White House, you know, sat down with a couple other people with Texas Public Policy Foundation and said that the right needed to take the lead. Conservatives needed to be involved in criminal justice more so than at any other time. And we see it today. We definitely need to hold the criminal justice system to the same level of accountability that we hold any other area of government. But our focus is public safety. We are not focused on emotion. We can't react to every single incident as an individual incident. We have to look at the whole picture and follow the evidence, follow the data. That's going to lead to a safer community. And we certainly agree that we have to have prisons. We have to have funded police departments. We believe in law and order. And we believe in consequences. But as a conservative, we also believe in the dignity of the human person. And once you have done what society or what our laws say that you have to do as a consequence, then we need to start removing some of these barriers. But doing so, again, keeping in mind public safety and victims as our primary focus.
Scott, we've got just a few more seconds. Where can people go today if they want to be part of what's going on?
They can go to the beautiful Elks Lodge at 102 West Washington Street in Greenwood. It's in downtown Greenwood. We'll have plenty of signage there, so you won't miss it. The mayor of Greenwood is going to be speaking. We have MDOC and several other individuals, and then we'll have an opportunity to network throughout the day as well.
Well, that's wonderful. Scott, thank you for being with us. This is Lucien Smith in for Paul Gallo on the Gallo Radio Show here on Super Talk Mississippi.